Centaur Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Devil's Due by Rachel Caine, narrated by Jennifer Aquino. Prologue. Case Notes. Lucia Garza. File number 2005-02281. Privileged and confidential. Investigation subject. Benjamin McCarthy, 44-year-old white male. Background. Exemplary Kansas City police detective. Decorated multiple times and given awards for meritorious service. Served with the KCPD his entire career, from 1985 until his suspension and subsequent conviction for murder in 2003. Incarcerated in the Ellsworth Correctional Facility. Appeals continue. Personal. McCarthy was born and raised in Kansas City to a middle-class family. Background prior to joining the police department is relatively unexceptional. Scholastic history indicates high aptitude for problem-solving. Parents reside in a retirement community in Arkansas. One brother, a commercial fisherman living in Florida. No evidence of close ties with other, more distant relatives. Never married, although he has been involved in two documented serious relationships, both prior to becoming a detective. Neither with Jazz Callender. See separate file. Facts of the case. At 2:34 a.m. on October 4, 2002, three bodies were discovered, bound hand and foot, shot in the back of the head, execution style. Victims were identified as Joseph Lozano, 23, a convicted drug dealer. Catherine Cat Vargas, 18, Lozano's girlfriend. And Navio Veracruz, 19, also a known drug dealer. No drugs or money found on the bodies. Forensic investigation yielded several key pieces of circumstantial evidence, including tire tracks taken at the scene and footprints preserved in mud. However, the ballistics tests came back with a startling result. The bullets matched another case on file that had recently been entered in the computer system, an officer-involved shooting. The bullets came from the service weapon of Detective Ben McCarthy. McCarthy was unable or unwilling to provide a reliable alibi for the time in question, including any corroboration from his partner, Detective Jasmine Jazz Callender. Convicted on the basis of ballistic and forensic evidence, he was sent to Ellsworth for 30 years. Callender insisted on his innocence, but no supporting evidence was found. It does not appear, even on detailed examination of the facts, that Detective Callender was party to his criminal acts. Her dedication to clearing her partner's name has been noteworthy during the period of his trial and incarceration, and likely resulted in the state in which she first came to my attention, broke and verging on a serious drinking problem. Additional note. Files regarding Detective McCarthy's case and Callender's investigations were stolen from her apartment recently, during an apparently unrelated breaking and entering. We have turned up no information about the whereabouts of the files. New evidence. Last month, Callender received a set of photographs via former FBI agent Manny Glickman that show McCarthy at a separate location during the time period of the murders. Manny Glickman has been investigated. His background is clear and, in many ways, more convincingly above reproach than Callender's. See separate file for details. Photographs show McCarthy accepting envelopes from two known members of an organized crime family and are evidence of corruption. This explains why McCarthy chose not to use the alibi at trial, relying instead on the hope that he would be acquitted. Separate investigation has thoroughly authenticated the provenance of these photographs. I accordingly submitted the photographs and supporting materials to the district attorney and McCarthy's defense team as exculpatory evidence. The district attorney, moving a great deal more quickly than is typically the case in these matters, has moved to vacate McCarthy's conviction. On a personal note, I wonder at the speed with which this has been accomplished. In my professional experience, the right thing rarely happens quickly in the judicial system. Lucia Garza, partner, Callender and Garza Investigations. Chapter 1. The gavel fell, and Ben McCarthy was free. Mira, that was fast, Lucia thought, stunned. She'd been expecting something else. A bit more theater, perhaps. At the very least, a token few questions or some fussiness from one attorney or the other. The prosecutor looked pale and drawn in the early morning hour, squinting against the harsh overhead lights. She was a hard-looking woman, with dark hair and a fashion sense that tended toward square-cut shoulders and block skirts with sensible shoes. No doubt she won a lot of cases, but it wasn't on style points. Lucia didn't begrudge her the lemon-sucking expression, considering how humiliating it was to have to publicly acknowledge a prosecutorial mistake of this magnitude. This had been a gigantic miss for the cops and the district attorney's office. A murderer had gone free, and a cop, not a good cop, granted, had been wrongly accused and convicted. McCarthy's life was over, professionally speaking. He was damn lucky that it wasn't over in every sense. The time he'd spent behind bars had been hazardous. He had the mended bones to prove it. As soon as the gavel hit wood, McCarthy turned to look over the sparse crowd in the courtroom. Looking for Jazz Callender, Lucia knew, because he and Jazz had always been close, and it was reasonable to expect her to be present for his exoneration. As Jazz would have been, if not for a conspiracy between Lucia and Jazz's beau, James Borden, to keep her safe at home. The judge rose in a flutter of black robes and escaped back to his chambers. Apart from the usual complement of guards and court stenographers, there was the sour-faced prosecutor, the cheery defense attorney, Ben McCarthy, somehow still neat and striking even in a prison-issue jacket, three bleary-eyed reporters, and a man sitting two rows ahead of Lucia, hunched forward. McCarthy's eyes gave up the search for Jazz and fastened on her, and Lucia felt an undeniable surge of something. Not a handsome man, McCarthy, not in any sense she could name, but there was something about him that was compelling. Clear blue eyes in an expressive face, a force of personality that could freeze you solid or melt you to syrup, depending on his mood. She'd learned that quickly during their prison interviews. He wasn't tall. In fact, in heels, she probably topped him by an inch. But he was strong, and there was something graceful about him. The way he moved, the deft, neat hands. She saw the flash of disappointment, but the flash was only that. And then he smiled at her, a warm smile, and nodded his head. This wasn't unusual. Men smiled at Lucia Garza a lot. She was beautiful, and she was a careful steward of the gift. She took pains with her hair, her makeup, and her clothing, and she stayed in shape. She was used to male attention. And still, that smile made her go entirely too warm in secret places. They'd gotten to know each other well these last few weeks, while Jazz was recovering from being shot, and Lucia assumed the primary investigator spot for McCarthy's case. It had started cautiously, but Lucia, much to her surprise, hadn't found McCarthy the typical closed-off cop, nor the equally typical closed-off prison burnout. He'd been interesting, literate, and smart, and cool. She had, in fact, interviewed him more than was strictly necessary, professionally speaking. 15 visits in all, 2 with Jazz, the rest without. He had remarked the last time that it had been the best interrogation of his life. She'd subsequently spent more than a few hours wondering why Jazz had never succumbed to temptation with McCarthy. But Jazz had assured her, the third time loudly and profanely, that she'd never slept with him and never really been tempted. They just hadn't clicked. Whereas Lucia seemed to be clicking with him like a castanet. She stood up and willed herself to keep it cool and professional. She edged down the row to the central aisle. McCarthy stopped to exchange some words and a back slap and handshake with his attorney. Then, a not very cordial look with the prosecutor as she snapped her briefcase closed. No handshakes necessary on that one. He turned toward Lucia and took 2 steps in her direction. Someone came between them. A man, tan suit, rounded shoulders, wire-tight body language. Lucia scanned him instantly with the unerring instincts of someone who'd spent sweaty months in counterterrorism training. The man spelled trouble, even from the back. He wore a cheap summer weight suit coat with a grubby look, as if he'd worn it for months at a time. Even from 10 steps back, Lucia had the unmistakable impression that he needed a shower. He wasn't much taller than McCarthy, and a great deal more nervous. From behind him, Lucia could see the jangles and twitches in his arms and legs. Emotion, possibly, or drugs.
McCarthy, she heard him rasp, in a voice like silk ripping on wire. You son of a bitch.
Ben McCarthy's face went still, the blue eyes opaque. He shot one fast glance at her over the man's shoulder, and then focused on his opponent's face. McCarthy stayed still, a total contrast to the man facing him, who had tension vibrating through every muscle. Lucia could feel it like an electrical field as she moved steadily forward. She had her weight poised, in case she needed to move fast, and she focused in on the balance points that were her targets. She didn't have a gun, a wholly unusual circumstance for her, but that wasn't an issue. Neither did the man facing down McCarthy.
Stuart, McCarthy said. Hey, thanks for coming.
Ken Stuart, Kansas City Police Department, Detective First Class. Lucia let the adrenaline course a little faster, let her heart rev up another couple of beats per minute. Stuart was, at best, unpredictable. At worst, Jazz's bitter assessment came back vividly. He's got the winning personality of a Rottweiler raised by wolves. He'd always struck her as volatile, but now she was convinced he was a Molotov cocktail in search of a lit match.
You think I'm here to smile and kiss your feet like these other assholes?
Stuart asked, and took another step into McCarthy's space. McCarthy didn't back away. He tilted his head a few degrees to continue to stare into the other man's eyes.
You hear me? I'm not letting you just walk away from a mass murder, you bastard. If it's the last thing I do, I'm happy to make you pay.
McCarthy said nothing for a few seconds, then glanced at Lucia.
Detective Ken Stuart, he said, calmly and steadily. Meet Lucia Garza. Since she's a witness to you threatening me, you should probably be formally introduced. Oh, we've met, Lucia said crisply, as Stuart turned around to look at her.
He had blue eyes, too. Crazy ones, shallow as glass. His skin looked pasty, unpleasantly shiny, and his hair stuck up in greasy spikes. Very unattractive indeed. He tried the crazy eye with her. She stared back, a faint smile on her lips, until he whipped back around to McCarthy and muttered something under his breath, then pushed past to talk to the prosecutor. It was comforting to see that the prosecutor didn't look any happier to see him, especially when she entered ground zero of his body odor. McCarthy took a deep breath, let the coldness fade from his face, and said,
"Sorry about that."
He came the last few steps to join her, but his attention was still on the other man, who was haranguing the prosecutor in a low, furious voice.
No problem. It isn't the first time Detective Stuart and I have locked horns. No?
That caught his attention, with a vengeance. He was wearing a blue sport coat that was too large for him, blue jeans that were perfectly acceptable, and a plain open-collar shirt. No tie. Relaxed for a court appearance, but then he'd been there to get out of jail, not to try to avoid going in. He smelled of a particularly cheap aftershave and an underlying astringent scent that was probably prison issue as well.
He's made a run at Jazz a few times, Lucia murmured.
Ben started walking toward the courthouse doors. She kept pace.
Bet she handed him his nuts on a platter, he chuckled.
Lucia grinned.
I don't think she bothered with the platter. Yeah. She's not much in the kitchen.
So,
where is she? I admit, I kind of expected to see her.
McCarthy opened one of the doors and stepped aside to let Lucia pass. She glanced at him, but there wasn't any calculation in his eyes. It was automatic gentility. He wasn't even aware of doing it. She suppressed another smile as she thought of how little gestures like that would have chafed on Jazz. She liked her independence and saw every common courtesy as an infringement upon it. Jazz should have been born in the Old West, where she could have made a living on the frontier, riding rough, drinking hard, and swearing at the top of her lungs. Calamity Jazz. McCarthy was fishing for an answer to a question he hadn't asked. Lucia obliged.
Truthfully, Borden and I kept her away. We didn't want her presenting a clear target.
James Borden had volunteered to keep her distracted,
not exactly a sacrifice. The man had been madly in love with her for almost a year, and the significant lack of Jazz's presence this morning might mean that they'd finally tipped over from flirting to something more. Or alternatively, knowing Jazz, it can mean she'd had a massive fight with Borden, gotten drunk, belligerent, taken on a motorcycle gang in a fist fight, and was celebrating her victory with a hospital visit. McCarthy looked somber. She okay?
She's fine.
You're sure?
I'm sure.
Again, a little white lie. Jazz was all right in one sense, in that the past few months had been a huge change in her life. Since the day Jazz had been given her first red envelope, the same day that Lucia, halfway across the country, had received one, her life had been an uphill climb after the downhill express she'd taken following McCarthy's arrest. But the offer Lucia and Jazz had jointly received to open a new detective agency with funding from a rich but highly secretive donor organization had come with tripwires attached, and Jazz had been a casualty. When they'd followed the last lead, from instructions in one of those damn red letters from the Cross Society, she'd nearly died. Lucia had no idea how much of that Jazz had shared with her former partner. Knowing her, probably little. No new envelopes had arrived recently. Lucia allowed herself to think that perhaps, just perhaps, the insanity was over. A faint hope, but she refused to abandon it just yet. All of this unexplainable conspiracy theory stuff was just too odd to live with for long, if you expected to have a firm grip on reality. McCarthy had noted her brief mental detour. Somebody's still gunning for her, right?
Why do you say that?
He grinned, a flash of humor that lit his eyes like sunlight.
Hell, you tell me. You're the one who kept her out of the courtroom. Well, somebody was gunning for her. Are they still?
Lucia shrugged.
I don't know, but I prefer to be careful.
Good plan.
They moved out into the hall, and he suddenly stopped walking. She looked back at him with eyebrows raised. He surveyed the corridor, the people coming and going as the day began to come alive, the glow of dawn outside the courthouse windows. His eyes had a wet shine to them, tears.
McCarthy?
She asked gently. He took in a breath.
Yeah, freedom. Kind of took me by surprise, he said. Give me a second. Take your time, she murmured.
She knew how it felt. There had been a dark time in her life, pitch black, in fact, when she hadn't been sure she'd ever see daylight again. The emotional impact of realizing that the trauma was over, that you were free. It could be overwhelming. It wasn't relief. It was terror. When you get used to the dark, the light can burn you. He blinked and smiled slightly.
Sorry, he said, and cleared his throat. So, want to have breakfast with an ex-con? I mean, it's not like we're not acquainted already. 15 hours of interviews has to count for something.
First, second, and third dates, most likely. She cleared her own throat, banishing the thought.
I'd love to. Gotta confess, I'm low on funds. They confiscated your ill-gotten gains?
She made it an ironic question, not quite accusatory. He met her eyes without shame.
I asked them to, he said. Wanted to start out fresh. Ah, my treat then.
He offered her the crook of his elbow. She put a hand in it, and they resumed their walk down the long paneled hallway to the free world. Chapter 2. Over breakfast at the restaurant in the Raphael Hotel, which was a good deal fancier than his suit jacket warranted, McCarthy wolfed down a hangover omelet stuffed with chili, chorizo, and potatoes. Lucia stuck to a large fruit cup and dry toast. She enjoyed watching him eat. He seemed enchanted with everything he tasted, but then she supposed nearly 2 years of prison chow would do that. She suspected he was always a bit of a sensualist. Something about his eyes, his smile, the clever exact movements of his hands. She pulled herself back from the dizzy edge of that thought and said, Do you have any idea who could have used your gun to commit the murders? because the circumstantial evidence had been convincing. McCarthy's gun had been matched to the bullets in the bodies. There had been footprint evidence at the scene, too, and an eyewitness who'd seen McCarthy with the victims half an hour before their murders, although Lucia doubted the authenticity of that. Eyewitnesses were often wrong.
"Oh, I know who did it,"
McCarthy mumbled around a mouthful of eggs and cheese.
"Stuart."
"He didn't."
"Crazy enough."
Jazz checked it out. Stuart had an alibi.
"So did I. Funny how that is."
Stuart was booking a carjacker downtown at the time of the killings, in front of 20 other cops. McCarthy studied her with those intense blue eyes as he chewed and swallowed, wiped salsa from his lips, and for a second, she thought he was going to argue the point. Instead, he said,
"So what's your story?"
"Excuse me?"
15 hours of talking, and I don't think you said boo about yourself. Name, rank and serial number, but you didn't exactly meet me halfway. So tell me how you got mixed up in all this, and why the hell you care about a guy like me."
Lucia was, for an instant, thrown. She disliked talking about herself, especially when faced with someone like McCarthy, who was certainly a damn good investigator. She chose her words carefully.
"Did Jazz tell you how we came to be partners?"
"Yeah, a letter to each of you, offering to put up the money to open a detective agency, some kind of non-profit agency. I get why Jazz took the deal.
Why did you?"
"I didn't," she said, and speared a slice of electric green honeydew.
"I turned it down."
She enjoyed the look on his face as he assimilated that.
"I was leaving when Jazz got shot in a drive-by attack. You know about that?"
He nodded shortly, face set.
"I had my doubts about her as a partner," Lucia continued. "But I don't like people shooting at me, and I don't like people shooting my friends, even new ones. So I decided that it might be a good idea to stick around. One thing led to another. Cases came up. We solved them. And here we are."
She nibbled the fruit. He watched her, concentrating on her mouth, and she felt a surge of self-consciousness that surprised her. Something about McCarthy threw her off stride. He made her hyper-aware of how her clothes fit, of the tiny imperfections in the way the sleeves hugged her arms, the way the lapels didn't quite lay straight, the way her skin shivered into goose flesh when he stared at her. McCarthy tilted his head.
"Jazz is a walking disaster, but somehow, she does okay. She's also a pretty good judge of character, me notwithstanding."
He continued to watch as Lucia chewed and swallowed.
"I know what you mean about sticking around her, though. I wasn't going to be her partner. I was just saddled with her for a week. But she grows on you. You want to protect her from herself. Doesn't generally work, though. She ends up saving your ass more than you save hers. And before too long, you're joined at the hip. And then you realize that's not a bad thing.
Regarding ass saving, I believe the score is just about even between us now," Lucia replied.
"That tells me something about you."
"What?"
He surprised her with a wicked grin.
"You're damn good at what you do, whatever it is. Obviously, I'm a private investigator. And I'm your maiden Aunt Sally," he snorted. "I've known a lot of PIs over the years, and none of them ever came looking or sounding like you. You avoided the question. What's your story?"
"I'm avoiding the question because I don't want to answer it."
"Because?"
"Because it's none of your business, Mr. McCarthy,"
she said evenly, and took another bite. Pineapple, fresh and sweet and pulpy. She savored the juice on her tongue and the look of surprise on his face.
"I helped Jazz get you out of prison, that's all. I don't owe you any information, any conversation, or anything else."
"Yeah?
So what's this?"
"I said I don't owe it. I can still give it of my own free will."
He demolished the omelet, and now he set his fork on the plate with a clink and took a drag of coffee from the heavy white cup. Around them, the well-groomed breakfast crowd in their expensive suits and trendy casual wear chatted and smiled.
"We're both out of place here," Lucia thought,
even though she seemed to fit seamlessly into the crowd. There was something different about McCarthy that spoke to the wildness at her core. It wasn't his prison-roughened image. McCarthy smiled at her. Okay, so you don't owe me. I was hoping you liked me enough to want to answer anyway.
I don't like anybody that well.
Harsh.
Pragmatic, she countered. I hardly know you, except that you might not be guilty of murder, but you're surely guilty of other things. Add that to the fact that your friends and relatives were hardly crowding the gallery today.
His face shut down even further, hiding emotion. Lids drifted lower to hood his expressive eyes.
Let's leave them out of it, he said. I was a cop, and my buddies were all cops. Cops stay away, times like these, until they feel better about the facts. Stuart's not the only one who still, deep down, thinks I pulled the trigger on those people.
McCarthy stared at his coffee and took another deep swallow.
My brother would have been here, but he's on a tuna boat this season. My parents...
He shook his head. She took pity on him. I doubt they could have made the trip, she said.
Your mother is ill, isn't she?
Old, he said.
Your folks still alive?
She smiled noncommittally. So I'll forgive you the low turnout among your admirers. Still, it does say something, doesn't it? To have more reporters than supporters. She got a thin slice of a smile.
Careful when you cut me like that. You'll have to buy me a new shirt. I'll bleed all over this one. I'm tempted to buy you a new one, whether you bleed all over it or not.
That's kind-hearted of you.
Call it fashion charity.
He was studying her again, with lazy interest.
I just can't picture you and Jazz as friends.
Why?
She's just one of the guys, you know? Not so...
He gestured vaguely, letting her finish the sentence with whatever adjective seemed best. Wise of him.
I was surprised how good she looked last time I saw her. Your influence or the counselor's?
He knew about Borden then. Yes, of course he did. Lucia shrugged.
Maybe both. She's not drinking so much.
No.
Not getting into fights.
Well, we're working on that part.
Good luck with that.
He grinned and caught the attention of a passing waiter to get a refill on his coffee. He drank it black as the devil's heart.
So, if you're not going to tell me anything, I'll just have to tell you three things about yourself, Miss Garza.
Is this popular at parties?
A riot on cell block 6.
Then please, enlighten me.
1. You manipulate people. Sometimes for their own good, but always to your advantage.
He sopped a piece of toast in a remaining bit of peach jam and ate it, watching her reaction. She kept her face bland, but felt the barbs sink unpleasantly deep.
2. You use your looks as deception. You look warm and girly and elegant, but I'll bet you can hand most guys their asses in a fight.
He was right again, of course. She didn't allow herself to blink.
And 3? How am I doing so far?
We'll see.
And 3?
He shrugged.
You're lonely.
She laughed out loud.
Excuse me? You heard? Hardly. I didn't say you don't get attention. Every guy in here has checked you out at least once, and half the women, too.
I said you were lonely. A woman as beautiful as you is nothing but lonely. Even when you're with somebody, you're wondering if they're into you, or the glossy package. And sweetheart, just from the 16 hours that we've been talking,
I can tell you that you're high on the paranoid scale anyway. So the point is, you don't let anybody close these days.
It hit hard, under the armor, right in a soft place she didn't know she had. Years of dealing with a string of men who'd professed love and delivered obsession. Years of mistrusting and holding back and staying cool. For a second, she hated those blue diamond eyes and their ability to see everything.
You're wrong. I'm not lonely. Far from it.
He gave her a slow smile.
That tells me something else about you. You think you're a good liar. And hey, for most people, you are.
Do you make a habit of insulting people who do you good turns?
Usually they want something. Speaking of that, what is it you want?
Once again, he caught her off guard.
Me? I'm only here out of courtesy.
Courtesy?
It has something to do with manners. Perhaps you've heard of those.
Sorry, not exactly popular where I've been.
She'd struck a nerve. She could see it in the subtle reactions of his face.
You just came in Jazz's place, is that it? Second string?
Lucia took the insult without reaction.
I want her to be safe, yes.
What about you? Aren't you in just as much danger if the two of you are supposed to be partners?
It was an excellent question, and one to which she didn't have an answer. They were working for the Cross Society, but she had only the vaguest hints as to who those people were and how they operated. For all she knew, the danger that Jazz had run into head-on had come from someone inside the Cross organization. She'd seen cutthroat competition in non-profit groups, but if true, that might be a new low. In any case, whether it was the Cross Society or, as their mysterious benefactors insisted, the rival Eidolon Corporation, they hadn't sent soldiers after Lucia specifically. She'd only been in the vicinity. Jazz was the target. Then again, the enemy didn't seem prone to doing gentlemanly things like firing warning shots. Lucia wondered if McCarthy had deduced why she'd taken a table in a protected corner that had no direct view from the windows. She'd also stayed vigilant for any hint of trouble. The only problem she'd identified so far was an overdose of cholesterol that was surely going to spell trouble for McCarthy's arteries in the future. She let him see her confidence, embodied in a slow smile.
I think I'm safe enough, she said.
Why? Are you volunteering as a bodyguard?
Well, McCarthy said, I do need a job. Prospects coming out of the big house aren't good, unless you're into loading trucks, making French fries, or beating up people for a living.
It was said lightly, but she heard the ring of truth. There was a certain grimness in his eyes, the set of his mouth, as he finished his coffee in a long sip.
Okay, the truth. I've got $100 in my pocket right now. My apartment's long gone, and the KCPD wouldn't have me back even as a janitor. So yeah, I wouldn't kick a little work to the curb. Bodyguard, investigator, whatever, if you need it. Your job prospects aren't any worse than for anyone else walking out of jail. Since my job used to be a police officer, yeah, I think they kind of are. Look, I never deserved to be there in the first place. I lost 2 years of my life to this crap.
He'd gone intense again, head inclined toward her, voice urgent.
I don't even know where I'm going after breakfast. You know how that feels?
She did, but it didn't seem the time to tell him so.
You begin your life again. That's what people do, Mr. McCarthy. Start over. Reinvent themselves. Become someone new, and hopefully, better. Nothing wrong with who I am right now.
Isn't there?
She raised her eyebrows slowly.
Are you sure?
She accepted the leather folio containing the check from the waiter. McCarthy gestured for her to hand it over.
I already said I was paying, she said. Remember? That was before you pissed me off. Now I'm paying.
Don't be ridiculous, she retorted,
and pulled her wallet from her black leather purse. It was specially reinforced to hold her containers of mace, clips of her gun, a 6-inch collapsible truncheon, handcuffs, and sometimes but not today, a taser.
You'll have a hard enough time without worrying about picking up the check for me. Then I'll owe you and pay you back.
Without a doubt. This isn't a date, and I'm not some prison groupie.
Ouch. She really hadn't meant it to be so harsh. He was staring at her, hands on the clean white tablecloth, just watching, as if he knew that last part had been, in some small measure, a lie. She had found him attractive. And yes, this had been a date, hadn't it? Unorthodox as that might be. She handed the folio to the waiter, who whisked it off so quickly his apron fluttered. Probably afraid that Ben McCarthy, who was looking more than a little feral in his cheap coat and ragged haircut, might come after him and wrestle him to the ground for it. As she watched the waiter go, she said, "Allow me to make some insightful comments about you, Mr. McCarthy."
Just Ben, he interrupted. This Mr. Miss crap is getting old.
Fine, Ben. You are tough, clever, and you're probably the single best liar I've ever met in all of my life, and I've met almost as many as you have.
Her turn to score a hit. She saw him blink, saw the prison-hard Ben McCarthy waver for a second to reveal someone far less armored.
Why do you say that? He asked.
Because Jazz never believed you were guilty of anything, she said. And you were a dirty cop. She's incredibly sharp, and you had her completely snowed for years. Do you have any idea how much that hurt her, by the way?
He stared at Lucia for so long that she felt uncomfortable. Whatever was going on in his head, none of it was showing in his face.
Yeah, he finally said. I know. And you're right. I'm a son of a bitch.
Have you changed? Has prison reformed you?
He gave her a small, cynical smile.
Doesn't it reform everybody?
Outside, the day was cool and clear, the sky a pale, sun-bleached blue. Lucia took in a deep breath to catch the scent of damp earth and green-growing things. She missed that, living in the city. Hadn't been out to hike and climb for too long now, other than on gritty training ranges. She had the credentials to visit Quantico if she wanted to do so. The woods there would help her get her center again, and she could visit the gun range for an excuse. And God knew, the Marines would be more than happy to drive her to the edge of endurance in heavy, sweaty field exercises. The valet arrived in her silver Lexus, parked and stepped out as she came around to the driver's side. She was watching McCarthy over the top of the car, but something caught her eye. Something about the valet. Not right. Something. McCarthy was talking to her. It was noise. Her world had narrowed to the out-of-focus blur of the valet standing there, holding the door for her. She started to turn her head toward him, and as she did, she saw his hand emerge from his pocket. A brilliant glint of silver in the morning light. Fear bolted through her, there and gone, replaced by a deadly smooth calm. Too late. I'm too late. She brought her elbow in, drove her left forearm out in a stiff arc. It hit squarely against his extended arm and knocked his hand into the doorframe.
Ow!
The valet stepped back, surprised, and what he'd been holding thumped to the ground. A small metal clipboard with a receipt stuck under its holder.
Jeez, lady, chill. I was just getting a signature. New policy.
She felt herself blush in the adrenaline chased out of her system, leaving a thick aftertaste of embarrassment. She apologized as she retrieved the clipboard and signed on the line next to her tag number. She slid a $20 bill under the clip holder. The valet's attitude improved considerably. In the silence of the car, McCarthy kept studiously quiet about it. She put the car in gear and pulled out, around the circular drive and back onto the street.
So, he said slowly, about that bodyguard job.
She glanced at him, at the ill-fitting sport coat, the prison-styled hair, the shirt, and shoes so cheap they were the next thing to disposable.
I've already got a bodyguard, she said. However, I could use another good investigator, under one condition. You let me make you look presentable. I wouldn't want you giving a bad impression to our clients.
Deducted from my wages, like a uniform.
If you insist.
I do.
Then yes, deducted from your wages.
Yeah, okay.
He eyed her mistrustfully.
When?
Now.
She thought for a few seconds, mentally measuring him.
32 regular, I think, she murmured. Italian cut. French collar and cuffs. How do you feel about McNanny?
Am I supposed to know what that is?
No. Shoe size?
10.
Fine. One other thing.
I knew you were getting to it.
I'm taking you for a haircut.
Do I get to pick the barber?
No. It will be a stylist, and there will be a manicure, and, if you're not polite, skin treatments.
He sighed and said,
pull over, I'm getting out.
I don't think so. We've made a deal. Believe me, this works better if you just let it happen.
Great, McCarthy said grimly. Just like prison, with product.
His reaction to being marched into Lenora Ellen's day spa was, she thought, gratifyingly furious. But she'd left them with strict instructions, and him with enough promises and threats to ensure his cooperation. Besides, she could see that he secretly craved a little relaxation and pampering, so long as he never had to admit it to, say, Jazz. Ben's fate sealed, Lucia turned to practicalities. Her overreaction with the valet was out of character for her, to say the least, but it told her something of what her subconscious was doing, worrying excessively. It was time to set up some insurance, and she pulled her car into a parking spot outside one of the most exclusive men's stores in the city. She had a speed dial number on her cell phone that she'd once promised never to dial again. She'd never been good at keeping promises when it came to Omar. He picked up on the second ring.
"Tell me you're not in trouble," he said, and she laughed because it was just like Omar.
"Okay, then tell me you hit the wrong number in your speed dial."
"No, querido, I'm calling you, and maybe I'm not in trouble. Have you ever thought of that?"
"No," he said.
"I heard you'd moved. Kansas City, right?"
"Right."
"Would it surprise you to know that I'm in the neighborhood?"
"Tremendously."
It didn't. Stranger things had happened every day before breakfast. "Just finished up a job in St. Louis. So, I'm sure you didn't call just to hear my voice, lovely as it may be."
And it was lovely, low and full of warmth. Just now he was using his native accent, which was cultured and British, but he was equally at home with French, Spanish, American, German, and a wide variety of Arab inflections. She'd even once, hilariously, heard him do a fabulously broad Scots.
"I adore your voice, which you very well know," she said. "But no, I was checking to see if you were available."
"Well, I'm not currently seeing anyone."
"Professionally."
He became quickly serious.
"Long term or short?"
"I don't know. We'd best say at minimum a month."
"Huh. Usual rates?"
"Have they gone up?"
"Cost of living, my love. Cost of living. Or at least the cost of not getting killed."
She sighed. Omar did not, of course, come cheap.
"Fine. Your usual rates, plus expenses."
"Starting when?"
"How soon can you get here?"
He was silent for a few seconds.
"Lucia, this sounds a bit more serious than your usual tangle. It's not our mutual uncle?"
Meaning Uncle Sam, of course. "No, strictly private. And it's not serious, exactly. Just uncertain."
"I'm peace of mind, then."
"I can think of no one better."
"But of course."
She could imagine his wide, charming grin.
"I am reliably informed by the wonder of the internet that there is a morning commuter flight leaving in 40 minutes. Where do I go?"
She gave him the office address.
"There's a parking garage. We're on the second level. I heed you positioned there today."
Watching for what exactly?"
"I don't know. Call me when you're in position."
2 hours, he said.
After a beat, he said,
"Lucia, it's nice to hear from you."
"Likewise," she said. "Don't get arrested in the airport."
He laughed. It was something of a standing joke, but not a very funny one, all things considered. Before she could say anything else, he was gone. She sighed, ordered her thoughts, and got on with her part of the bargain with Ben McCarthy, shopping. One of the first things she'd taken the trouble to do when she'd moved her operations to Kansas City was to find the premier clothiers in town, for both men and women. She had a personal interest, of course, but there were always professional considerations. Clients to dress, undercover agents to outfit for special assignments. And she always did like to buy quality. She was choosing the right suit to flatter McCarthy's coloring and body type when she realized that she was being followed and had been for some time. She kept her movement slow and natural as she placed the suit back on the rack and turned to a display of French cuffed shirts. White would make his prison pale skin look even more translucent. She held up one the color of cream, studying it and readjusted the focus of her eyes to the mirror a few feet away. There was someone outside the store, looking in. He was in shadow, backlit by the morning sun, but she recognized the ill-cut suit. Detective Ken Stewart was dogging her. Why me? Why not McCarthy? Although the thought of Stewart infiltrating a day spa made her smile. Stewart backed up and moved along, an easy stroll, as if he'd just been idly browsing. He was good at this. That was disturbing. She much preferred dealing with amateurs and professionals who had inflated ideas of their skill levels. If she hadn't spotted him before... You weren't looking for a tail, she reminded herself. You had no reason to suspect anyone would follow you on something as mundane as this. Maybe not, but she'd been hyper-aware with the valet. It bothered her that she'd missed Stewart. After a few more seconds, another man passed the glass. This one short, fat, and dressed in a dirty blue jean jacket. Shaved head. He hesitated at the door, then opened it and came in. He looked nervous, but that might have been the natural tentativeness of a man ill-used to high-end suits coming in to browse. No, it wasn't. In the mirror, his eyes focused on her, not in the way that a man normally examined her either. This was a pattern recognition way, as if he'd been given her description, or a photo. She carefully put the shirt back on the table and positioned her hand close to her hip. A split second from going for the gun concealed by the tailored jacket she was wearing, she automatically swept the store for collateral victims. The clerk was positioned safely behind a counter. He'd surely duck if gunplay started. Odds were good he'd survive, unless her newcomer was carrying an Uzi or was an incredibly poor shot. No other customers, unless they were in the dressing rooms. Nothing she could do to minimize the risks. She balanced her weight lightly around her center, ready to shift at a moment's notice, ready for anything, as the man made his way closer, one hand in his jacket pocket. She'd humiliated herself with the valet. She wouldn't make the same mistake twice. That meant waiting until a weapon was actually visible and identified, which would put her at a disadvantage. But she turned, and time slowed to a crawl. Tick. And his eyes were rounding in surprise. Tick. And her hand moved the small distance inside her own coat, her fingers touching the cool grip of her gun. Tick. And his right hand emerged with nightmare slowness from his pocket, carrying a red envelope. Time fell back into a normal rush of color and noise, and Lucia felt her heart hammering, knew there was heat flooding her cheeks. Adrenaline was an earthquake in her veins for the second time in an hour. The courier held out the red envelope to her. Here you go, lady. No signature required. He sounded spooked. She wondered how she had looked to him in that instant when she was making the decision whether to kill him. Thank you, she said, and took it. Automatic courtesy. She certainly wasn't feeling grateful. He backed up and hurried out of the store fast enough to make the bell hung over the door clatter like a fire alarm. She turned the envelope over in her hands, frowning down at it. The size and shape of a greeting card envelope. It felt like one sheet of paper inside. Her name was block printed on the outside. The courier had, no doubt, been told exactly when and where to find her, even though her choice of this store had been an impulse. No point in delaying the inevitable. She reached in her purse and took out a slender little pocket knife, flipped it open, and slit the side of the envelope, very carefully, preserving what evidence there might be. She slid the paper out with a pair of tweezers from her purse and moved shirts to lay it flat on the table. It didn't require much scrutiny. It read, "One of you has made a mistake." And the letterhead said Eidolon Corporation. Easy enough to fake if someone went to the trouble of doing it. No signature. She held it up to the light. No watermark. No secret messages. No hints as to its meaning. "One of you?" Meaning her? Jazz? McCarthy? A member of the Cross Society? Impossible to tell. It was a meaningless taunt, a message designed to unnerve, showy, like the delivery by courier, designed to prove that they could literally find her anywhere. Just like the Cross Society, presuming that someone in the Cross Society hadn't sent it in the first place. Stewart had been following her.
Was it possible he was Eidolon? Eminently, she decided. Cross-society? She hadn't exactly been provided with a full and forthright disclosure of their membership, but somehow she couldn't see Ken Stewart believing in the things that the cross-society took for granted. Things like premonitions and psychics and the ability to alter the future. Then again, maybe that explained the erosion she sensed in him. The jittery nervousness.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.